Hello friends, please accept my compliments to all of you and all the best for your bright career in the field of higher education. I have gone through all the stages of all these developments as a teacher, and therefore, based on my past experience, I think that the youngsters in this field of higher education, especially the teaching community, need to know the total facet of higher education as well as the governance architecture of higher education, and that too in the perception of Indian context. Now, before I list out the deliverables of my talk to you, as an academic part, let us understand as to what is meant by governance. Those who come from commerce and management faculty must be knowing that Peter Collins' Dictionary of Business gives a lot of concept clarities in the field of commerce, management and industry. So, Peter Collins defines governance as the philosophy of ruling. It is the theory of the way an institutional entity should be run. This definition is obviously for the corporate governance. We are in academic field. Obviously, we also shall have to understand as to what is the governance function in the field of college and university education. I have evolved some definition for this governance function. Governance is the schematic architecture of functional compliance. I say that it is the schematic architecture. And about what? About the functional compliance to ensure objective and effective running of an institution with vision, mission, goals, objectives and strategies, acts, statutes and regulations, systems and procedures, set of rules, and over and above that, ethical traditions and conventions as the guiding principles or guiding determinants, as well as regulating, directing and governing determinants. When I say governing determinants, obviously, I mean that ultimately governance has to be a particular function, and governance has to have some particular objectives, and from that point of view as to how the governance is to be set is dependent on the determinants, and therefore categorically I have used the word determinants over here. So, if it is the schematic architecture of the governance function, and for the ideal and objective running of the institution, and with some governance determinants as I have enlisted just now, with this background, now let us decide as to in this forthcoming lecture what will be the deliverables at the end. So, I will be focusing with these deliverables in my mind to know and understand. Number one, constitutional provisions regarding higher education. Number two, types of institutions in the field of higher education. Then the regulatory structure of this higher education system in India, in which the University Act is the most important document. So, the design of the University Act I will talk about, and finally, I would lead you all to the functional governance determinants. Of course, I will talk about some certain functions in the university system. Let us come to the first part, constitutional provisions regarding higher education. Many of you may be from the faculty of arts and with special subject as political science, they must have studied constitution. But those who are from commerce, management, science, technology and other streams, they may not be aware as to how the higher education system in the country is regulated through the constitutional provisions. In practice, we find that UGC, University Grants Commission, releases some regulation, but the state government says that we won't accept these regulations for the simple reason that state government think that it is their subject matter of control, whereas the central government has some subject matter. So, in the initial stage of our career, let us understand very clearly as to what are the control measures and the subject matters for parliament, subject domain, for parliament, that is central government, and that for the state government. And therefore, let us refer to Article 246. 246 article of constitution gives the list of subject matters for which either parliament, that is central government, or state government, or both will have the authority to frame some law. Article 246 talks of these subject matter of laws to be made by parliament and by the legislatures of state. Within Article 246, there are specifically four provisions, of which the important one and relevant to us we will refer to. The first clause of Article 246 categorically says about the subject matter for which parliament, that is the central government, has the exclusive domain. So, parliament has the exclusive power for all those subject matters which have been listed in list 1 of 7 schedule. Let me just concentrate on article number 246(1) I have talked about. Then the schedule is 7th schedule and the list is list number 1. So, first list of 7th schedule, as per sub clause 1 of article 246, talks of the subject matters which have the exclusive power. Let us concentrate on exclusive power. Exclusive means ultimately parliament and the central government will have the highest authority, and the acts which have been created out of this particular enabling provision, state governments cannot enter into that, they cannot cross, state governments will have to follow it. Second one, then what are the subject matters for the state legislature of the state? It has been enlisted in list 3 of 7 schedule. So, list 1 is for the center, which is central list, list 3 is the concurrent list. Now, when the word concurrent is used, intentionally I have choose this concurrent list 3 first and then I will talk about list 2. It is the legislature of any state, and see the articulation of the provision of sub clause 2. It says that the legislature of state also, let us underline the word also, because immediately before I was talking about this, I had talked about the central list. So, parliament has the authority as well as the state government has the authority, and therefore, this is known as the concurrent list, list 3. Then what is list 2? That is given in the next sub clause, that is sub clause 3. And the opening statement of sub clause 3 says that subject to clause 1 and 2, the legislature of any state has exclusive power to make laws for some subject matters which have been listed in list number 2 of 7th schedule, which is termed as state list. When it says that it is subject to clause 1 and 2, so one has to logically understand that this sub clause 3 and the state list cannot override the authorities which have been given to central government under list 1 and in the concurrent list, that is list 3. So, these are basically three lists. Besides that, as you know, in our country there are some geographical areas which are not within any particular state. They are neither state, but they are separate territories, very categorically termed as union territories, like Andaman, Nicobar, Lakshadweep. For them also somebody has to have authority constitutionally, and which has been provided in the next sub clause of article 246. It says that parliament has the power to make laws with respect to any matter for any part of the territory of India not included in the state. So, that geographical territory of the country which is not a part of the state, like union territories, the state government has the authority over the state list also, because it is not the state and there is no specific authority like the state government over here. So, just to recollect, list 1 is central list, List 2 is the state list, list 3 is the concurrent list, and these three lists one has to read by letter and spirit if one has to understand as to what is the constitutional provision for governing higher education system. Therefore, I will have to refer to the serial number clauses of those lists. Let us talk of those clauses now, and for which let us refer to different lists, list 1 and list 2 and list 3. So, list 1, if you can recollect, list 1 is discussed in sub clause 1 of 246, and it refers to some serial numbers in sub clause 2. So, those serial number of list 1 are 63, 64, 65 and 66. 63, when this constitution was adopted by the country, that time Banaras Hindu University, Aligarh Muslim University, Delhi University, they were in existence. So, all these have been covered in serial number 63. It means that all these universities are central universities, and everything related to central university is the subject matter of central government, because it comes under list 1. Institutions of national repute, national importance are also covered over here, like IIMs, IITs. Ultimately, they are governed by central government because it comes under serial number 63 of list 1. The next one is serial number 64. Institutions for scientific or technical education financed by Government of India, wholly or partly, and declared by Parliament by law to be institutions of national repute. I have just made the reference to IITs, IIMs, and besides that, some institutes of specific scientific category like NCL in Pune, National Chemical Laboratory, that institute is termed as the institutions of national importance, and it is governed by Parliament because it is at serial number 64 of list 1, that is the central list. Serial number 65, for that matter, is the union agencies and institutions for professional, vocational or technical training or promotion of special studies. Here, I would like to refer to the first word, union agencies and institutions. So, central government, that is Parliament, has the exclusive power to establish union agencies and institutions for professional vocational training. For example, for professional and vocational training, engineering institutes, All India Council for Technical Education, the details of which I will be referring later on, this AICTE has been established because of the enabling provision of serial number 65 in list 1. So, UGC, AICTE, Medical Council of India, National Council for Teachers Education, all these come under the central list, and all those acts have been drafted and passed by the Parliament. They have different role to play in the academic standards, which comes under serial number 66. The next one, serial number 61. This is very near and dear to all of us in the field of higher education. Coordination and determination of standards in institutions for higher education or research and scientific and technical institutions. Here, let us understand, institutions for higher education, what does it mean? All colleges in the country, all institutes of management in the country, all technical institutes, universities. Now, the coordination and determination of standards, of academic standards of all these institutions, is at serial number 66 of list 1. Just to correlate all these things, who has the ultimate authority over the determination and coordination of academic standards? It is the Parliament of the country, which has this authority to have or establish some laws. And this is the very, very important aspect of higher education. to which later on in details I will refer to. So, after understanding serial number 63 to 66 of list 1, let us talk of state list. Some of you may be from different states. For example, in Maharashtra, if it is the state of Maharashtra, then state of Maharashtra also have has the exclusive power to make some acts. And as we have seen in the beginning, it is given in list 2. The serial number 14 of list 2 talks of agriculture. Well, you must know that agriculture is the subject matter of state control, state governance. Obviously, the agricultural education, agricultural research also is the exclusive domain of the state government, because it comes under the state list. And same thing is true to the complementary field of agriculture, that is livestock. So, preservation, protection, improvement of stocks, stock over here means livestock, and prevention of animal diseases, that is all veterinary degrees and veterinary training and practices is the exclusive domain of the state government. Now, list 3, concurrent list of the 7th schedule. When it is the concurrent list, obviously the central government, that is parliament, and the state legislature both have the enabling power over here. Serial number 25 of concurrent list is related to higher education. So, education including technical education, medical education, university education, subject to the provisions of entries 63, 64, 65 of and 66 of list 1. The entries and the details we have referred at length. So, subject to those provisions, the vocational training as well is also included. Now, in the field of higher education, this serial number 25 of list 3 of 7 schedule with reference to article 246 must be a Bible word, must be a Bible sentence for all of us, because we are in the teaching field. If somebody questions you, who decides the academic standard in the field of higher education, you must articulate the answer with reference to all these constitutional provisions. So, if I am to correlate list 1 and list 3, list 1 serial number, that is clause 66, says about coordination and academic standard. Exclusive domain is with state parliament, that is central government. Whereas, the serial number 25 of list 3, that is the concurrent list, talks of the additional authority to the state government to make some laws. So, with this background of constitutional provisions, let us now go further and talk of two specific acts which cover around 85% of the higher education institutions in the country. Why 85? It may be 90% even. That is non-professional colleges, technical institutes, scientific research institutes, all these are covered in these two acts which I am referring to. UGC is the focus act for all of us. Intentionally, I would like to recollect serial 66 of list 1 of 7 schedule. What is serial 66? It talks of the coordination and academic standards. So, coordination and determination of academic standards comes under that particular serial clause number 66. UGC Act, when it was promulgated in 1956, the very preamble of UGC Act talks about this. Well, one must understand that whatever act it may be UGC Act, AICT Act, or for that matter any legislature, any enactment, the very preamble, the first opening sentences of any act talks of the basic objective or intention for which this enactment has been made by parliament, by central government or by state government. So, why UGC Act? The very preamble talks about it, that an act to make provision for the coordination and determination of standards in universities and for that purpose to establish University Grants Commission. So, when University Grants Commission was established in 1956, it was for making the provision for academic standards, coordination and determination of academic standards. What does it mean? Let us go into a bit details of it about the UGC Act. Coordination and the standardization of the academic standards. So, if UGC has the exclusive authority under constitutional provision by Article 246, UGC will always release some regulations of academic standards, and all those academic standard regulations released by UGC will be mandatory pan India in all the states, because that is the exclusive authority of center. By the Act of Parliament, UGC is established, and therefore all these things come together. So, one needs to understand the links, then the interdependence and the architecture in which all these legal provisions have been made. Same thing is true for the technical education. Serial number 65 talks of the technical education and union agencies to be established. So, All India Council for Technical Education has been established. The preamble even of this act will talk about the same reference again. The preamble of AICTE Act says that it is an act to provide for the establishment of an All India Council for Technical Education with the view to the proper planning and coordinated development. Here there is a slight difference between UGC and AICTE. UGC talks about the academic standards, whereas AICTE Act preamble talks about the planning and coordinated development. So, All India Development of Technical Education System is one of the important aspects for which this act has been established. Besides that, the promotion of qualitative improvement. Let us recollect clause number 66 of list number 1 of 7 schedule under Article 246, qualitative improvement, academic standards, again it comes to. And finally, it is the proper maintenance of norms and standards. So, my friends, now you will recollect, when UGC was established, there is a linkage to constitutional provision. When AICTE was established, same. What for this institute has been established? The reasoning has been given in this preamble, and accordingly one may say that the academic standards and norms is the exclusive domain which at present is functional in the country of the central government. So, with this brief about the constitutional provisions, let us summarize as to what are the cardinal principles of understanding. Let us critically understand as to what these provisions are. So, of that, education including technical education, medical education, universities, vocational and training, technical training, that comes under concurrent list. The coordination and determination of standards of these is the exclusive subject matter of central list. It is through establishment of union agencies, as we have seen, UGC, AICTE, NCTE, MCI, and accordingly various regulations are issued by UGC from time to time. And when the regulations are related to academic standards, they are supreme. As regards technical education, AICTE is the apex body to regulate planning, coordination, quantitative and qualitative development of the technical education in the country. For establishment of non-technical colleges, I have just given this example. I want to put before you the example. If one has to establish a college, then prior permission of UGC is not needed. Why? Because the preamble of UGC says that UGC is the agency to monitor the academic standards. It is not the permission granting agency. But as against that, AICTE is is having the authority to grant permission. So, if one has to establish engineering college or management institute in any state, the prior permission of AICTE is needed, and the permission given by AICTE is supreme. The next cardinal understanding up till now is that the state governments also have power to make laws with regard to education, including technical, medical, vocational. But these powers cannot override the coordination and determination of the academic standards, which is the domain, mandatory domain of UGC and central government. So, it means that the coordination and determination of standard will be looked after by UGC, it will be mandatory for all states, will be looked after by AICTE regarding the technical education, which will again be mandatory in all states. Very recently, UGC is changing the academic standards and the curricula and so many things, and all those are very, very mandatory. But besides the mandatory regulations related to academic standards, these central agencies time and again release some other regulations also. For example, in 2012, UGC released one regulation related to students' grievance redressal mechanism. And you will be surprised, in 2012, in that regulation, UGC said that in university system, for the appropriate grievance redressal of the students, there has to be the appointment of ombudsman. I doubt as to how many public universities in different states have followed this. Now, one question may crop up over here. If UGC as a central agency has issued the regulation, why is it that some state governments are not following it? Because this is not related to academic standard. This is related to grievance redressal. Same thing is true for service conditions. All these are regulatory circulars which are issued, but they are recommendatory. They are not binding, the state government is not bound to follow them. It reminds me of some of the regulations about fifth pay commission, sixth pay commission in past. UGC issued regulations about the minimum qualification of teachers. For example, many of new entrants like you in this field of higher education, you must have cleared your NET or SET examination, you must have B plus in your postgraduate degrees and PhDs and MPhil, and unless all these are fulfilled, a candidate cannot become a teacher. Why? That talks of the minimum standards for academics. So, they are mandatory. But within the same regulations for fifth pay and sixth pay, UGC has given the composite scheme, which talks of age of retirement, which talks of leave package, but they are not related to academic standards. Therefore, they are recommendatory. So, one can say that all these central agencies can issue mandatory and regulatory regulations, directions, or rules. Those which are related to academic standards, I am repeating again and again, those which are related to academic standards, they are mandatory. Those which are related to other complementary issues in the field of higher education, they are recommendatory. Some governments, some state governments may accept it, some state governments may not. When it comes to age of retirement, even today you will find that different states have different rules about age of retirement. Somewhere it is 58, somewhere it is 60 years, somewhere it is 62, somewhere it is 65. So, those are recommendatory, because they are not related to academic standards. Of course, it is a fun to say that as the age grows, the academic depth and experience of that teacher also becomes matured, and therefore, why should it not be termed as academic standards? But forget that lighter part of the story, ultimately it is the constitutional provision which governs. So, with this first phase of what I have suggested is the constitutional framework.